And there are those who derive their identity as a Christian from the fact they're part of a Christian family. But as Billy Graham used to say, if you're born in a garage, that doesn't make you a car. And one of the big illusions that many of us may have is that because I'm part of a Christian family, because my parents are Christians, because I go to church with them, therefore, by association, I'm a Christian.
Just suppose God searched through heaven and couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed for to buy eternal life for you and me. And oh, had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, and had it not for the old rugged cross, and had it not been for the man we call Jesus, then forever my soul so glad he was willing to drink this bitter cup. And although he prayed, Father, let it pass from me, yet I'm so glad he never called on heaven's angels. From these hands, oh, the nails that torment me. Oh, had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, and had it not been for the had it not been for the man we call Jesus, then forever my soul would be lost. Then forever my soul.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a trip of a lifetime that celebrates all things Israel. From November 17th through to the 27th, 2016, join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we explore Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, you'll visit Via Dolorosa, the Mount of Olives, Beit She'an, Caesarea, Mount Carmel, and many more amazing destinations. Ignite your faith. through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hilary Price and special guests during a two-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
I'd like to personally invite you to join Hilary and myself for a wonderful and rich experience in the land of Israel in November 2016. We're calling this trip Awaken 2016 Israel. Whether this is your first trip to Israel or you're returning with us to this beautiful, significant country, imagine a journey where you'll immerse your senses and deepen your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Most of the key events in Scripture took place in the land of Israel. And we'll visit places whose names have probably been familiar to you for many years. We'll be fascinated by the historical sites and events and be able to soak up spiritual significance that is associated with them. This is a vacation like no other. You'll enjoy the sights, sounds, and great food of the Holy Land, as well as wonderful warm fellowship with like-minded travelers. And we've set aside ample quality time to refresh and rejuvenate the spirit. Towards the end of our journey, we'll stop and take time in the Word of God together. Hilary and I will teach at a two-day haven of reflection in a private venue right on the shore of Lake Galilee. Our hope is that we may encounter the living Christ and come away in a deeper relationship with Him. Awaken 2016 Israel holds the potential to invigorate us physically, to enrich us socially, and to refresh us spiritually. Like many who have journeyed with us before, you may come home knowing you'll never be quite the same again. Don't miss this opportunity. Please join Hilary, me, and the Living Truth family on this exciting journey. We hope to see you in Israel in November 2016.
Save these dates, November 17th to the 27th, 2016. To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time. This special Easter message is called New Birth Through the Resurrection of Jesus Christ.
I want to read you a couple of verses now, which we will talk about, that explain the theology, the doctrine, give the explanation for what it means for Jesus Christ to be raised from the dead. I'm going to read from 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter writes this, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." A survey was conducted recently that asked people what they thought of when they heard the word Easter. 12% said Jesus, 62% said chocolate. And there's probably a good reason why that was the way around it is. This Easter in Canada, we anticipate $210 million being spent on chocolate across the nation. That works out at something like $75 to $80 worth of chocolate for each person. I hope you get your share. My wife gave me an Easter egg this morning. I brought it with me. I don't know if you can see it. This is absolutely true. This is my lot. So I'm going to make it last. But I thought I'd let you see it first. Apart from eating chocolate, something else is unique about this day in the annual calendar, and it is that across Canada today, more people will be in a church than on any other day in the year. Some statistics indicate around 20% of the population will be in church. I find that a bit difficult, but to really believe that, that would mean about 6 million people, one in every five people you meet is going to be in church. In the GTA, about 1 million people will be gathered somewhere in church today, but that is the statistic. But if that is so, it is interesting to set it alongside a statistic by the Pew Research Center. This is one from 2011, so it's just a few years out of date. And that said that 66% of all Canadians identify themselves as Christian, 39% as Protestant, 27% as Catholic or Orthodox, and of course, Quebec lifts that figure quite significantly. So that means this: on the best attended church day in the year, which is today, less than one-third of those who identify themselves as Christian will be in a place of worship. That means something important. It means that lots of Christians who identify themselves as that, at least, have become thoroughly disillusioned with Christianity. Now, disillusionment is a good thing, of course, because to become disillusioned about anything is to lose the illusions that you had in the first place. So I always welcome disillusionment, because then you're seeing through the illusions. The problem is that many have turned away from the Christian church and turned away from the Bible and turned away from the message of Jesus Christ because they think the illusions they don't like actually are the realities and is the truth. Let me suggest a few of the illusions that seem to be around. One is that Christianity is passed on through the environment. A lot of those folks who said, I'm a Christian, did so because they were born in Canada. And Canada theoretically has been called a Christian country, and therefore, by virtue of the environment I am in, I'm a Christian. There are those who say, well, I'm in a Christian church. I was baptized as a baby, and that brings me into the kingdom, which is an illusion, but it's held by some. I followed up with confirmation when I got into my teens, and that gives me the Holy Spirit, another illusion, good to get rid of. Or that there are somehow virtue in the bread and wine of the communion or the mass, and that in participating in that, I become a participator in the gospel. That's another illusion. Now, there are those who may believe these things, but they also know it doesn't work. It doesn't really do very much for you. And there are those who derive their identity as a Christian from the fact they're part of a Christian family. Parents are Christians, brought up as a Christian. And so the assumption is, I'm a Christian, or the assumption other people make is, you're a Christian because I know your family. But as Billy Graham used to say, if you're born in a garage, that doesn't make you a car. And one of the big illusions that many of us may have is that because I'm part of a Christian family, because my parents are Christians, because I go to church with them, therefore, by association or by contamination, I'm a Christian. Some of us hope our kids will imbibe Christianity. We put them in a Christian school, Christian environment, in the hope that somehow they will imbibe it and it'll become part of them. But many, to our heartbreak, know that doesn't work. You cannot catch Christianity like an infection. If you hang around people who are sick long enough, you'll probably get it yourself. People don't breathe out Christian germs, and you kind of pick them up in the atmosphere, and something happens to you. These are illusions that people are well rid of. regarding Christianity. But I want to talk to you for these minutes this morning about why Easter Sunday and the events of Easter Sunday are indispensable to what it means to be a Christian. They are fundamental to what it means to be a Christian. They are non-negotiable when it comes to what it means to be a Christian. And I'm taking the clause I want to talk to you from 1 Peter 1, verse 3, where Peter writes, "In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." I want to talk about these three things: the new birth into a living hope and made possible only by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And let me say to you at this point that the conclusion of the service this morning, I'm going to invite many of you to enter into a living relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here today because it's Easter Sunday, but really there's nothing that really grabs your heart about the Christian gospel or about Jesus Christ. And my prayer is that God will open our hearts, open our minds, open our understanding. And at the end of this service, I'm going to ask those of you to whom God is speaking to do something. It'll be open and public, to indicate I am entering into a new relationship with God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. First of all, then, Peter says he has given us new birth. This term, new birth, or to be born again, is a biblical term. It has become devalued somewhat in recent years. It's become a euphemism for change, which is something quite different to the New Testament meaning. So if you renovate an old house, it's just about falling down, and you rebuild it, you talk about it as being a born-again house. Or your business is in big trouble and goes to the wall, but somehow you revive it and it's a born-again business. Or your marriage is facing the rocks also, and you are able to revitalize it and revive your marriage, and you say, "I have a born-again marriage." These are terms that are used about what it means to be born again. I saw an article in a newspaper 10 years ago, and the article was on born-again Muslims. Now, there is no such doctrine within Islam, but what the article was talking about was people being converted to Islamic extremism and going off to engage in various acts associated with that. And they described them as born-again Muslims. What do they mean? They've suddenly discovered a whole new excitement about being a Muslim, a whole new focus and purpose and zeal. That's not what it means to be born again. Even in reincarnation, in some religions, when you die and if you behave yourself, you come back, you know, as something a bit nicer. If you didn't behave yourself, you come back as a cockroach. And that has been called being born again in the next life. That's not the New Testament use of this term at all. So for many people, it means to see the light. It means to change your mind. It means to reinvent yourself. It means to reprogram something. And we say that's been born again. None of this is its meaning. And the term is a term of Jesus first used in John chapter 3 when he talked to a man called Nicodemus. I'm going to read you just part of that for a moment. In John chapter 3 and verse 1, it says, "There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council." In other words, he was high up in the religious hierarchy of Jerusalem, part of the Sanhedrin council. And it says, he came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God." And this is how we know: no one could do the miraculous signs you are doing if God were not with him. In other words, he said to Jesus, there's something about your life that is inexplicable other than God is with you? And Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Nicodemus, you're absolutely right. The explanation of my life is that God is with me. God is in me. My Father lives in me. And Jesus talked about that much later. As a man indwelt by his Father. But Nicodemus, don't you understand? Unless you too become the recipient of a new life, unless you are born again, none of this will ever make sense. Unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven. It won't even make sense to you. And so Nicodemus asks, how can a man be born when he's old? Nicodemus asks, surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Well, that's an obvious thing to say. What do you mean be born again? I was born however old Nicodemus was. I was born 49 years ago. How in the world can I go back into my mother's womb? But what are you talking about? And Jesus said, and I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh. The Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. Now, when he says that unless you're born of water and the Spirit, the born of water is simply referring to physical birth, because he goes on to say flesh gives birth to flesh. And so in physical birth, we are conceived by our parents. But he says there has to be something else. At the beginning of that birth process, the waters break. Maybe that's a particular reference to being born of water. But flesh gives birth to flesh. Human life gives birth to human life. But you must understand equally that spiritual life gives birth to spiritual life. And there must be a spiritual birth in your life. Nicodemus, you don't imbibe this, you don't catch this, you don't hang around Christians and get this. You have to be born again. Earlier in John chapter 1 and verse 12, John had written, to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. If you're going to be a child of God, there has to be some supernatural birth that is taking place. The Amplified version of the Bible, which I sometimes quote, quotes that they owe their birth neither to blood, nor to the will of the flesh, not to physical impulse, not to the will of a man, that is, of a natural father or mother, but to God. They are born of God. God has to do something. Now, there are two things that this tells me. One, this is a supernatural birth. This is a work of God. No person, no priest, no evangelist, no pastor can bring this about in somebody else's life. No Christian church, no Christian home can do this for us. It is not an infection. It is personal, and it is a work of the Spirit of God that takes place in your heart and my heart, privately, personally, individually, irrespective of the context I am in. When I say it's a work of God, it's a supernatural birth. Jesus said to Nicodemus, the wind blows where it pleases, you hear its sound, you cannot tell where it comes from, where it's going, so is everyone born of the Spirit. I had a brother, we grew up in exactly the same environment. He's 18 months older than me. We were exposed to exactly the same things. And there came a time in my life when I became a Christian, and he to this day is not a Christian. What happened? Same environment, same church, same Sunday school, same everything. The Spirit of God awakens our hearts. Now we can quench the Spirit of God. We can resist him. The scripture makes that clear to us. But it is the Holy Spirit who awakens our hearts, who then begins to draw us. He puts a new desire into our hearts for God. He creates a seeking and a searching and a restlessness and the awareness that something isn't right, something is missing. And as I've prayed about this morning, my sense has been that in these services today, this morning and this afternoon, there will be those of us who are aware of that in your heart. It's the gestation period that is bringing you to the birth. The restlessness that says there has to be more to life than this. It's a supernatural birth. The Spirit of God is drawing you. Secondly, it's an indispensable birth as well. You see, you cannot have a Christian life until you have a Christian birth. You cannot live a life you do not have. That's why Jesus said to Nicodemus, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. By saying no one will see it means it won't even make sense to you. And I know absolutely fully there'll be those who leave this place this morning and it will not have made sense. But there are others of you, and the sense, the jigsaw pieces are coming together. And you're beginning to see it. And you're ripe and ready to be born again of the Holy Spirit. And so I read earlier from John 1 that he gave the right to become children of God because they have been born of God. What gives a person a right to be a child of God? That they have the life of God implanted within them. That's what gives them the right. That's what gives my children the right to be part of my family. That my life, my wife's life has been passed on to them. You might have a dog at home or a cat. We have a cat, unfortunately. Her name is Molly. She's 12 years old. But supposing you have a dog, and supposing you call him Fido. Isn't that the classic name for dog? Well, if you call your dog Fido, that's all you call him. He doesn't carry your family name. He might be a well-behaved dog. He might have a beautiful temperament. You might have a sticker on the back of your vehicle that has mummy, daddy, three kids and a dog. And the people driving by think, oh, that's a family of five, whatever it is, including the dog, four, six, is that? Whatever it is. But if we had a dog called Fido, it would not be called Fido Price. I would not appear on its birth certificate. Why? What does it take for it to be excluded from my family or your family? It doesn't have to misbehave. It doesn't have to smell badly. It doesn't have to bite the neighbors. It doesn't have to make a noise when it eats. All it has to do is be a dog. And as long as it is a dog, that's enough to separate it from your family. To be outside of the family of God, to not be called a child of God, as Jesus said in John 1, is to not have his life, to not be born again, to be separate. And so he's given us new birth. That is the first aspect, that is the consequence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it's a new birth into a living hope. That's the second aspect. Hope of what? There is a present and a future tense in the following verses. And I will comment just briefly on them. The present tense comes later in verse 8 and 9 of 1 Peter 1. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Now, the present tense of those statements are these. You do believe in him. You are filled with inexpressible and glorious joy. You are receiving the goal of your faith, your salvation. In other words, in the present tense, life has suddenly begun to be whole and complete. You know, it's inexpressible and glorious joy he speaks about. We can feel in the doldrums. We can feel that our backs are against the wall. We're in trouble and we know nothing of actual practical joy. We're just mourning. But deep in our hearts, there's a security. He says inexpressible. It's buried deep in your heart is a security and a joy that comes from being restored to God. C.S. Lewis, well-known writer, has a book called Mere Christianity. It's some radio talks he gave during World War II, actually. And this is the transcript of them. And one thing he writes there is that as cars are designed to run on gasoline, so human beings are designed to run on God. Gasoline is not an optional extra to your car. It's a fundamental necessity. God is not an optional extra to our lives functioning as they were intended to function. His presence in our lives is the fuel, the gasoline. A car without gasoline doesn't necessarily do anything wrong. There may be nothing wrong with it at all. It just can't do anything right. It can't function as a car is supposed to be. It might be new, cleany, and shiny, and you park it outside your house and the neighbors are impressed with it, but it doesn't go anywhere. If you're going to use it at all, you just use it to maybe keep a few chickens in or some rabbits or the dog. That's about all you can do with it. It's not what the designers had in mind when they put the car together. No, for that it needs gasoline. You and I by nature are not what God had in mind when he put us together because of the fall back in the beginning of time whereby we became separated from God. And as Paul writes in Ephesians, separated from the life of God, then the solution of the gospel is to restore the life of God, the very thing you've lost, to put the gasoline back into the tank. It's not about reformation. It's about regeneration. You must be born again. And if there's a present aspect of this living hope, there is a future aspect as well, because in verse 3-5, he says, in his great love, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, never spoil, and never fade, kept in heaven for you who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed at the last time. Three great things here about which I haven't time to say very much at all. But the first thing he says, this includes inheritance already prepared, already reserved. It can never perish, never spoil, never fade. You know, when you are ready to die, you're actually ready to live. When you're not ready to die, you're not equipped to live. Because you live always with this fear the guillotine's going to fall any moment. And everything's going to be over. But through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have this future certainty as well that there is a resurrection in which you and I will participate. There's inheritance, can never fail, never perish, never spoil, never fade. And secondly, he says, we are being shielded by God's power as we wait for it. That's fantastic. You're not shielded by your own ability, by your own protection. It's by the power of God. The full facts are yet to be known. We're shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation is ready to be revealed in the last time. This is going to be bigger than we ever think, richer than we can ever imagine. That's the future aspect. But we're living in the now, so I'm emphasizing the now, the present tense, that we have been reconciled to God, indwelt by his Spirit. And the third thing he says is that he's given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, there in chapter 1, verse 3. So now we come to Easter. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is a historical act. We have talked on this platform before at previous Easters about the historicity of this fact and the evidence for that. But it's not just an impressive act of power As though you might say to somebody else, what did your religious leader do? Really, is that all? You won't mind it? He rose from the dead. Beat that. You know, that it's impressive. It's a bit like my dad's bigger than your dad argument with kids if we relegate it just to that. No, it's not just a demonstration of power for its own sake. It's a means, says Peter here, to the salvation of human beings. Without the resurrection, there is no rescuing and saving and transforming. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 14 says, if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. Verse 17, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. Now, his death was a necessary prerequisite to this. But your salvation and my salvation is dependent on the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And I'll tell you why. In Romans 5 and verse 10, Paul writes there, if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, reconciled to him, that's what his death does for us, how much more? Here's something bigger, he says. How much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? His death reconciles us. We call that redemption in theological language. Buys us back. He reconciles us. Redemption. But then he says that we might be saved by his life. That's called regeneration. That is, that having been redeemed, we're then made alive. The Amplified Bible's version of that verse says, for if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, it is much more certain now that we are reconciled that we shall be saved and daily delivered from sin's dominion through his resurrection life. Our life that was raised from the dead is now gifted to us by the Holy Spirit to come and live. That's why the gospel is Jesus Christ living within us. We have to be forgiven in order to come into this. That's why Christ died, to deal with our sin, to reconcile us to God, that we might then be indwelt by his Spirit, indwelt by his life. But don't confuse the two and say the all-important thing is about being forgiven. Forgiveness is important. It's not the all-important thing. Forgiveness is a means to an end. The end being that I might be regenerated, might become born again of the Holy Spirit. If I want to make a purchase, I might go to the bank first to get some money. And then having got some money, I go and make the purchase. Now, my visit to the bank is necessary, but that's not the object of the exercise. That's a means to an end. The end is making the purchase. Jesus Christ came to the cross, died, was buried. But says Paul, if he did not rise, you're still in your sins. If you did not rise, there is no gospel. He rose to complete what he began by his death, that the barrier broken down because he atoned for our sin, he paid in full for it, that now risen from the dead, he might impart his Spirit into us. Because our natural state is a state of spiritual death. In Adam all die, Paul wrote to the Corinthians. We were born that way. Just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, in this way, death came to all men because all men sinned. Now, if that's all you knew, it'd be very depressing. But as Paul writes, in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. In Christ is the possibility of coming to life. There's only one answer to death, only one, and that's life. But you know, we may not have spiritual life. We spend a lot of time preparing ourselves for viewing. You know, a bit like a spiritual mortician. You know, what do morticians do? They pump embalming fluid into the veins of the deceased person to make them have the right kind of color. They comb their hair. They apply some makeup. They get a nice set of clothes to put on them. And I remember once, in a funeral, this is absolutely true. With the casket open, somebody came by, looked at the body, and said, my, doesn't he look well? I haven't seen him look as well for a long time. Now, he was dead. but he looked well. It's amazing what a bit of makeup can do for you. And you know, we can be in a church like this morning. We can be in a church like this regularly. And we apply our spiritual makeup and people think everything's fine. But you know, when you go away from here, this is utterly boring to you, utterly empty to you, dead. And because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we may be saved through his life. Jesus said in John 14:19, because I live, you also will live. And he tells us how. On that day you realize I'm in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. This is a phrase Jesus used several times. You're in me, and I'm in you. We've been brought into union together where you've been identified now with me. You're part of my body, and my life now is in you. And you can know what Paul called the power of his resurrection. And this is the new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. I want to ask you this morning, have you been born again? There are three possible answers, I guess. One is to say yes. One is to say no. And the other is to say, I don't know, I'm unsure. But if you say I'm unsure, it may be because you feel that hanging around Christians, you might be. You come to church every week. You might be. You don't really know. If I were to ask you, are you married? There are only two answers to that question. You'd say yes or no. You wouldn't say, I don't know. You wouldn't say, well, you know, I've been hanging around girls lately, so maybe I am, I'm not sure. Or I went to a marriage seminar, I'm not sure if anything happened, but it may have done. I enjoyed being there. No, that doesn't work. And say, well, my parents were married and I grew up in their home, so I probably am. It doesn't work, does it? Marriage is a definite act in a moment of time. Comes a day when in front of a group of witnesses, a woman is asked, will you take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband? Will you love him, cherish him in sickness and in health, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer? And you say, I will. And the man is asked, will you take this woman, be your lawfully wedded wife, to love her and cherish her in sickness and in health, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer? And he answers, I will. And on those declarations, the person conducting the wedding will say, I now pronounce you man and wife. And at that moment, it's a done deal. You get the certificate afterwards that gives the date, the time, etc. Your status has legally changed, and you know. You know something? One day on the cross, on that first Easter, Jesus Christ was dying for your sin and for my sin. It's as though he was asked, will you take these men and women, these below the cross, playing callously with a dice to divide up your clothing? These who are mocking you and scorning you. Your disciples who have run away. And looking down through time, will you take those men and women who live in Toronto in the 21st century? Will you take them, Lord Jesus, and love them and cherish them and save them and look after them? And he said from the cross, I will. But that doesn't make a marriage. And this morning, God is asking you the same question. Will you take this Jesus Christ, who died as your substitute, took your sin upon himself, was buried, but was raised again from the dead in order that he might bring about a new birth in the lives of people who would receive him? Will you receive him? And he waits to hear your, I will. And at that moment, I pronounce you born again of the Holy Spirit, indwelt now by the life of God, equipped, empowered with gasoline back in the car, to live a new kind of life that will not just be in the present tense of this life, but which will go on forever and ever beyond this life. It will never perish. It will never spoil. It will never fade. What is your answer going to be? And I'm going to ask you, if you've never been born again of the Holy Spirit, you've never said, Jesus Christ, I take you into my life and I give my life to you. It's a mutual thing. He gives his life to you. You give your life to him. Maybe you're watching on television in your home or some other place and you have never come into this relationship with Christ for yourself. You too can pray this with me. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'm going to ask you to pray it with me sentence by sentence. If you have never been born again of the Holy Spirit, and this may be the most serious prayer some of you have ever prayed, confessing our sin, inviting the risen Jesus Christ to come and live within us. Would you pray this with me, clause by clause? Lord Jesus Christ, thank you that you love me. I confess I'm separate from you. I've been dead in my sin. But I thank you, you died, you entered into death for me. You paid for my sin. And you rose again from the dead, that you might impart that new life into the hearts of those like me who need you. I ask you to forgive me of my sin. I ask you to come and live within my life with a new cleanliness and a new empowering. Thank you for hearing my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Someone who would benefit from this message. Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel.
Be sure to tune in to Living Truth next week as Charles Price begins a new series called Job, From Tragedy to Triumph.
Teresa Cabrera came to Canada from Kenya.
I left at home my family, my parents, and my one sister. and I came here on my own. I came to go to school.
Like so many immigrants, Teresa experienced intense loneliness and frustration.
Sometimes it can get really lonely, and that can cause you to make the wrong choices or get into the wrong company or do the wrong things just because you need something to fill that space.
Despite her loneliness, Teresa stayed in Canada and became a Canadian citizen.
I had a job about 2 years ago. I support individuals with acquired brain injuries, and I used to work Sunday mornings. I used to watch TV, and one day I was flipping channels, and Living Truth came on. And the next Sunday, and it was back again at the same time. So I watched, and then I just had this connection with Charles Price. The things he would talk about, I could relate to it in my life.
And actually, what God was speaking to Cain about was his anger. Why are you angry? Sin is lurking at your door.
It was a really huge thing for me. I used to be just angry and bitter about things when they didn't go the way I wanted them to be. And I would do something wrong and I'm like, you know, whatever. I used to isolate myself, you know, just want to be alone.
But Cain did not master his anger. It mastered him. And if you don't master it, it will master you.
I got drawn towards him, and every Sunday I would go to work, I would turn on the TV and watch The Living Truth. And his messages were always so awesome, and they touched me in different ways every time I would watch it.
Very big decision.
Gosh, I was walking with my cousin in the park, and she told me, "Do you go to church?" I said, you know, I'm working, I'm a little bit busy, I try to go when I can.
Kind of this Sunday I'm working as usual, but I'd love to come to church. But you know what, when I'm at work, I usually watch this show called The Living Truth, mm-hmm. and the pastor is really awesome. His name is Charles Price. Do you
Charles
know him?
Price?
Yeah, Charles Price.
That's the church I'm going to, Kanyua.
Where?
People's Church.
I don't think he's in Toronto.
Kanyua, he's 3 kilometers from here.
One day I was feeling really sad, and I called her and she said, "Okay, today is the day." And I said, "No, I'm not ready." She said, "There's not going to be a day that you're going to be ready. Today is the day."
And she was like, "Yeah, but I've asked him to come into my life. Then I've asked him to come and be with me." So I told her, then she said, "There's nothing we're talking about. You've actually become a born-again Christian." She's like, "Really? I have? I was like, "Yes, you have. If you asked him to come, then he's here. It's really a matter of faith."
Teresa continued to watch Living Truth, and when she could, she attended the People's Church services.
If you have a Bible with you, I'm going to...
The way Charles Price preaches is so easy to understand. The things he talks about are so real. For my life, I felt like I just related well with everything he was saying.
The act of baptism, whereby somebody goes down into the water, is a picture of them dying with Christ, being buried with him, and then being raised again to walk in newness of life.
This year, Teresa made the big decision to be baptized.
I've done things in my life that wasn't right. I wanted to start all over again. I decided to get baptized because I would die in Christ and rise in Christ as a new person again. The Bible says that sometimes when you're at your lowest point in your life and done things that are not right for us, that's when you seek Christ. And I think I was at that point when I needed something fulfilling with purpose. Giving my life to Christ was the best decision I made. I wish I made it like 10 years ago. I don't know why I waited so long.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have him than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of the vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. Ooh, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to give. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his due cause. Oh, I'd rather have Jesus than wealth or fame. And I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of the vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. Ooh, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to give. You see, I don't want anything, and all I want is here.